Kramer, Uniontown, Pennsylvania. GMG3, Milton Francis de Gaulle, Jr., Savoy, New York. Seaman Apprentice, Ellison Allen Everhart, Jr., Cary, North Carolina. BM2, Gary John Fisk, Oneida, New York. Seaman Apprentice, Tyrone Dwayne Foley, Buller, Texas. Seaman Apprentice, Robert James Gedwin III, Lakewood, Ohio.
Brian Wayne Gendron, Madera, California. Seaman Recruit, John Leonard Goins, Columbus, Ohio. EM3 David L. Hansen, Perkins, South Dakota. GMG1 Ernest Edward Henyes, Bordertown, New Jersey. GMG2 Clayton Michael Hartwig, Cleveland, Ohio. LN1 Michael William Helton, Louisville, Kentucky. Seaman Apprentice Scott Allen Holt, Fort Myers, Florida.
Seaman Recruit Reginald L. Johnson, Jr., Warrensville Heights, Ohio. Seaman Apprentice Nathan O. Clifford Jones, Jr., Buffalo, New York. Seaman Brian Robert Jones.
Seaman Brian Robert Jones, Kennesaw, Georgia. Seaman Michael Shannon Justice, Mattawan, West Virginia. Seaman Edward J. Kimball, Fort Stockton, Texas. GMG3 Richard E. Lawrence, Springfield, Ohio.
FCSA Richard John Lewis, Northville, Michigan. Seaman Apprentice Jose Luis Martinez Jr., Hidalgo, Texas. BM3 Todd Christopher McMullen, Manahee, PA. Seaman Recruit Todd Edward Miller, Ligonier, PA. LN1 Robert Kenneth Morrison, Jacksonville, Florida. Seaman Otis Levance Moses, Bridgeport, Connecticut. GMG3 Darren Andrew Ogden, Shelbyville, Indiana.
Seaman Ricky Ronald Peterson, Houston, Minnesota. GMG3 Matthew Ray Price, Burnside, Pennsylvania. Seaman Recruit Harold Earl Romine Jr., Bradenton, Florida. GMG3 Jeffrey Scott Schellen, Costa Mesa, California. GMG3 Heath Eugene Stillwagon, Connellsville, Pennsylvania. Seaman Recruit Todd Thomas Tatum, Wolcott, New York. GMG3 Jack Ernest Thompson, Greenville, Tennessee.
GMG2 Stephen J. Weldon, Yukon, Oklahoma. GMG3 James Darrell White, Norwalk, California. Seaman Recruit Rodney Maurice White, Louisville, Kentucky. BM2 Michael Robert Williams, South Shore, Kentucky. Seaman John Rodney Young, Rock Hill, South Carolina. GMG CS Reginald Owen Ziegler, Port Gibson, New York.
Let's have a moment of silence for our shipmates and their families.
I now work for the Director of National Intelligence, so I had to run my comments through pre-publication review, and as most of you know, I have a hard time sticking to text, so I may have a security review on Monday when I get back to Washington. And as usual, I over-submitted comments so I could sort of pick and shape my remarks, and I've changed them completely since I met with folks last night. This was not easy preparing for this event today. 25 years. I made the 10th and I think the 15th. There were a lot of truths that Iowa came to stand for after the explosion, the litigation, the investigation. And it was very difficult, particularly in Washington. You saw people take it off their resumes that you knew had been on the ship. And that really annoyed me for many years because I kept my service on my resume even when I knew it would lead to very awkward discussions about events. And for those of us who came through the explosion, that awkwardness would often would ask you about it, would trigger the whole post-traumatic stress phenomenon where you would then go back and have to deal with all the issues that going through that event left you with. But what struck me the most was when my nephew went through Special Forces training in 2005. He'd been at Benning beforehand. And he called me on the phone. He called me on the phone because my father was a retired Navy captain, and John did not realize what an 06 was until he was at Fort Benning and realized that, like, the colonel is next to, like, the Dalai Lama down there. And he was like, wow, I didn't realize that Grandpa was, you know, an 06 was something that was important. I said, well, that's good. You'll be ready for a lot of that over your career. But at Fort Benning, they taught the Iowa as the incident of the highest unit mortality between Vietnam and the global war on terror. And that really struck me because we went through that, and at the time I had a passing thought that we just lost a third of our gunnery community in about 15 minutes. And yet none of our response from the wardroom, I think, really addressed that fact. And I'm gonna be a little controversial right now, my fellow officers that are in the audience, but I am going to apologize for the wardroom, for anything we did prior to the explosion, during the explosion, or after the explosion. In fact, let me amend that. It's not an if. If we, for things we did that were not appropriate for what officers should have done, I want you to accept my apology. And I will speak for the wardroom. I mean, I think it just has to be done.
Speak for yourself.
So I will speak for myself. I am sorry if I did anything that offended anybody. My observation on that day is that there was no failure of men. It was a failure of a weapon system, clear and simple. I think that was borne out over the coming months. There's a lot of scenarios that could have gone differently, but the bottom line, it was bad powder, and it was bad powder that flashed, and the men in that turret did everything they were trained to do, and I'm sure they did things they were even not trained to do to prevent the expansion of that explosion to the point where it would have taken our lives in addition to theirs. I think that's important because I spoke with some folks last night and it was not clear in their minds what caused the explosion, and the cause of the explosion was the powder. It's that simple. And that's not really up for debate at this point in time. It's been pretty much resolved. Beyond that, I think that Kathy asked me if I could recount something from the day, and what I found most interesting in my memory, the calling of the names after the explosion was really gut-wrenching, and Turret 1 was not prepared for that. Turret 1 was not prepared for me to order them to stay on station. My men very much wanted to go into Turret 2. It's a natural instinct. I had to think about Turret 1's ability to fight after it was all over, and I knew that the men were my biggest resource. I couldn't replace them easily. You can replace parts, you can replace hydraulic fluid, you can replace all sorts of things, but the men, because of their training, were not easily replaceable. During the event, my moment of terror, and it was the moment at which I thought we would be in the water at the end of the day, was after coming out of turret two, there was a medical emergency. We lost a very important member of our damage control team, at least temporarily, and the only person I thought had thought through exactly how to fight a fire in a turret. There was a reflash announcement that there was a fire again in turret two, and Webs and I had just seen the powder flats and a lot of powder broken out. We were not prepared for that. And the prospect that we could have a very large explosion in the base of turret two. Dale Mortensen and I triggered the sprinklers that day from inside the magazines of turret two. And I don't think we really had permission. I know we had a debate. We actually fought about it over the handle, whether we trip it or not. The folks in the turret had already moved forward to start putting the water down into the powder flats, and that really was what saved the ship. But we were thinking already that if there was an explosion of that powder in the powder flats, we would need to contain it, because if it went to the magazines, we would lose the front of the ship. I've spoken with some of you over the years regarding the next 72 hours after the explosion. My observation from that is that we're not meant by our God to see ourselves in that condition. And what I mean is that when you see human bodies in the condition they were in turret two, and I know this is tough to hear, it's tough, it's hard. And the damage of those moments stayed with some of our men for the rest of their lives. We're not meant to see it, we're often ill-prepared to see it. And as I signed out an affidavit for one of the gunners a month ago to get veterans benefits, if anybody needs documentation regarding your presence there on the day, just get a hold of me and we'll do it. I mean, it's not that difficult to do. It's also, there's a modern context to this, and that this is largely what our veterans from the current wars are bringing back from Afghanistan and Iraq. Many of their predecessors in Vietnam died on the field of battle. So we're now having a record number of men come back who've seen very similar situations in the field of battle, and they are going to be with us for the rest of their lives. And that is something that you should sort of take away, that this is not unique to the Iowa situation. Our men go forward, and women, and see these situations, and we have to be there for them afterwards. And I'm gonna close up very quickly here. There's something I wanna read, and I was gonna have it at my wedding, got excised out. Weddings are very difficult things to prepare. But I think it's something that really resonated with me the day of the explosion. As some of you know, my father was posted in his second to last tour of duty over at Commander of Eastern Atlantic Command in England. And we worked very closely with the Royal Navy. And he helped do the electronic order of battle for what became the Falklands War after we left. And there's a poem, it's actually a hymn, called Vow to Thee, My Country, which I found very helpful after the explosion. I vow to thee, my country, all earthly things above, entire and whole and perfect, the service of my love. The love that asks no question, the love that stands the test, that lays upon the altar the dearest and the best. The love that never falters, the love that pays the price, the love that makes undaunted the final sacrifice. I heard my country calling away across the sea, across the waste of water she calls and calls to me. Her sword is girded by her side, her helmet on her head, and round her feet are lying the dying and the dead. I hear the noise of battle, the thunder of her guns. I haste to thee, my mother, a son among thy sons. And there's another country I heard of long ago, most dear to them that love her, most great to them that know. We may not count her armies, we may not see her king, her fortress is a faithful heart, her pride is suffering. And soul by soul and silently her shining bounds increase, and her ways are ways of gentleness, and all her paths are peace. To my fellow survivors of that day, I extend my thoughts of peace and recovery. Thank you.
Now the mayor of Norfolk, Fraim. Thank you very much for coming, sir.
you, John. To the families of the 47 sailors lost in the explosion on board the Iowa, to their fellow crew members, to all who are here for this special occasion, it is an honor to stand with you this morning to remember and celebrate the lives of these brave sailors. Welcome back, welcome home. My remarks don't need to be filtered by anyone. I'm really just here to make the point, and I'll try to do it quickly. This community still remembers and still appreciates your service and sacrifice. Norfolk is proud of its naval heritage. It seems that no matter where you travel in this great nation of ours, when someone learns that you're from Norfolk, it is never a surprise to hear them say that they were stationed here in the Navy, or their family, or their father was, or a brother was, a sister, or a friend, or now in my case, my son-in-law is a Navy pilot stationed here. Our city is known around the world as a Navy town, and that's with good reason. We are home to the world's largest naval base, and over the years, Norfolk's waters have embarked more naval history than any other city in the country. And our citizens have given more than most in the defense of our great nation. USS Chesapeake was built here in 1799. She was one of the first six ships built for the U.S. Navy after the Revolution, and sister ship to Old Ironsides, the USS Constellation. And off this point where the historic Elizabeth and James River meet to form the harbor of Hampton Roads, the world's first ironclad battleships, the CSS Virginia and the USS Monitor, fought to a draw in 1862 and forever changed the nature of naval surface warfare. And from this base in 1907, the Great White Fleet set sail on a globe-circling cruise, announcing that America now had the world's second-largest navy. And the fleet was the embodiment of Teddy Roosevelt's philosophy of speak softly and carry a big stick. And it was here that the naval aviation began nearly a century ago, in 1910, with the launch of the biplane from the deck of the USS Birmingham. And where the universal symbol of American sea power was conceived, the mighty aircraft carrier. And through the years, hundreds of thousands of young men and women have sailed from Norfolk to faraway lands to defend our freedom, many never to return. Again, I say that to reinforce my point that yes, Norfolk is a Navy town, and yes, we are fiercely proud of that reputation, and yes, we are fiercely proud of all of you. So let me say again, it is an honor to be here, to be with all of you who have gathered this morning, 25 years to the day, following the tragic explosion in Turn 2 of the battleship USS Iowa, to celebrate the lives of 47 young crew members. We come to remember their sacrifice and their service to the country they loved to their last breath. They hailed from the East Coast and the West Coast, from the Northeast and the Great Plains, from the North and the South. They were a cross-section of America. And at the same time, we acknowledge their shipmates, who manned the fire hoses that extinguished the flames, who volunteered to enter the turret to search for survivors and to recover the remains of those who perished, and who by swift and courageous action saved their ship, and who all lost friends that day. Each has their memories, and each has a story to tell. There's an inscription located on Iowa's bulkhead that reads in part, "No battleship in the world has greater ability to withstand punishment and survive than we." The Iowa crew's tenacious fighting spirit that April 19th, had their resourceful, persistent willpower offer compelling evidence in support of that statement. I was a member of the Norfolk City Council in 1989 when word reached us of the explosion on board the USS Iowa. At first, we were shocked. But then, as the full extent of the accident became clear, shock changed to grief and sadness over the deaths of so many sailors in what remains the surface Navy's largest loss of life during peacetime operations. 2 days later, the city held a memorial service at Waterside on the banks of the Elizabeth River. It was attended by men and women in business attire, workers in blue jeans and t-shirts, active duty service members in uniform, and retirees. I was also there and remember it well. At that ceremony, Mayor Joe Lee called the Navy a part of our extended family. passing of time has only served to strengthen the sense of, that sense of kinship. Your Norfolk family has not forgotten the Iowa. If you've ever walked along the downtown waterfront, across from where the battleship Wisconsin is moored, you will have noticed a statue of the Lone Sailor, a sculpture that represents all who ever served in the Navy, all who are serving now, and all who have yet to serve. Arranged in a semicircle behind the sailor are granite markers, one for each Navy ship or submarine homeported in Norfolk that experienced a tragic accident at sea. Among them is one for the Iowa, sponsored by the Veterans Association of USS Iowa. It is a permanent reminder of those 47 sailors who perished on April 19, 1989. 25 years later, their loss continues to be felt by those they left behind and by those gathered here today. But in their honorable service, we should find comfort that they gave their lives serving a cause greater than themselves and greater than any one of us. They were serving their country. They were defending our freedom. And for that, we are eternally grateful. Norfolk remembers and will always remember Turret 2 and the men behind the guns. Thank you all, and God bless you, and thank you for letting me be a part of this.
Our final guest speakers, Larry Seaquist, he really needs no introduction, but many of us don't know that he's a state representative in Washington State Legislature. Larry has been a good friend and an honorable man as long as I've known him, and thank you for coming, Larry.
Thanks.
Thank you. You know, Mr. Mayor, I've got two condolences for you. One, it must be a real embarrassment to have a naval aviator in the family. It's too bad he couldn't have gone with the regular Navy. And you're also stuck with the number two battleship in the Navy. Heard when they said they want to see the battleship and say, well, yeah, I've got to go to L.A. to see it. So when John and I were talking about this, you know, for every one of us, you listen to those 25 names, and it's hard to imagine, 47 names, 25 years. The other thing that lasts, though, is the pride that every one of us have. It's still here after 25 or 27, or for those men, who sailed in the ship in the 40s and the 50s, and we've got some of them here too. So I wanted to say a word about some of the things I remember that I'm proud about, and I'm sure that every one of you is thinking today and many times during your lives, what is it that you really loved about going to see Iowa? You know, my wife, so every one of you had that experience of mom, wife, kids left behind. And what was extraordinary is how much they gathered together and took care of themselves, made sure that we on the ship knew, and of course every one of them had the broken refrigerator or the car that didn't work, and all of the things that happened to family members when we leave. So we really need to celebrate those wonderful family members that make a ship go to sea. The next thing I come to mind is full power trials. Now, when the ship was commissioned, we got any full power trial guys here? The plank owners did a fabulous job. They got this huge pile of steel that had a lot of cosmoline and a lot of other dirt in it, and spent an enormous amount of time getting that ship ready. It wasn't just the contractor, it was the crew. And we kept on working on that. It took about 3 years before finally had all the pumps tuned, hundreds of pumps, temperatures set, bearings changed for the fourth time, things set. And finally off here one day, we ran a full power trial. Now every time I tell the story, so we had this ship maxed out, you know. It was doing everything it was supposed to do. It took us quite a while even to re-engineer what that was. So here is this giant ship, and every time I tell the story, it goes a little faster. Last time I told it, it was going 50 knots, but it was actually I think it was about 36, 36.3, 37 knots. That's phenomenal. Can you imagine? You know, we could easily water ski behind that ship. The achievement of doing that with that much machinery, all eight boilers, all everything going at once is an extraordinary achievement. You know, to have done that, to take that ship that was that old and that machinery, beautifully designed, but to get it to run at max speed. In gunnery, of course, they had the same problem. Each one of those turrets weighed about 1,800 tons. You know, the rotating part of that turret was as big as a World War II destroyer, with all the machinery that went to that. And it was also full of cosmoline, you know, and just endless, you know, recycles. Gene Cosmic, I'm sorry he's not here, but the Cosmic finally figured out a way to do lube oil filtering. Is Cosmic? There he is! Hey. Woo! Hey! I'm trying to get a hold of him. Let's make sure we get his phone number before I go away. So, because of some firing gunnery accuracy problems of another ship that we shouldn't name, named New Jersey, we were not in the Iowa going to be allowed to go to the Iranian Iraqi war zone in the Indian Ocean until we had proven that we could fire. And we were in the Mediterranean ready to go. And the Greeks offered us the use of a little rock called Avgonisi in the Aegean Sea. And it's about, I think, it's about the size of this tent sticking out of the water. And it used to be. So we backed off, you know, 12, 15 miles and started doing gunnery with the RPVs, the Marines. By the way, I see some Marines here. There's one of them right over there. Talk about high quality. Our Marine detachment, in the Marine Corps, there's only two grades, OK and UNSAT. And our Marines got a 4-0 OK. They had an inspection of the security procedures that was what's called a closeout. Absolutely perfect. And so we had this fabulous Marine detachment. But at Avgonisi, we backed off, and the gunnery was fabulous. The Navy immediately gave us the green light to go through the Suez Canal. And Avgonisi is not the same rock it was before we got there. We shrank that little thing down. I don't know whether anybody ever apologized to the Greeks for reducing the size of their island. We got into the, before we then went out to Istanbul, have many port visits all over.
How about?
The other thing that I was really proud of is simply seeing the crew go ashore. Now, as all you know, in the Iowa, when we went ashore, we went ashore to visit the museums and the churches. Shows about the kinds of churches and the exhibits we'd seen. But every one of you had the experience of being up the quarterdeck with Master Chief Bobby Scott, standing at the head of the ladder, right, to make sure that you were squared away when you went ashore. And when Iowa's crew went ashore, that was America visiting that country. So in Istanbul, we had the Prime Minister on board. We had all of the dignitaries as we were doing the honors from our country to theirs. But the real, America's real diplomats were the crew of the Iowa when they went ashore and showed what America was like, what sailors were like, what our country was like. I was so proud every time I went to see the crew go ashore. And it's really sad that Bobby Scott isn't here or Master Chief Chuck Hill, and those folks. We had in the chief's mess, in the goat locker, this amazing group of leaders, you know, just astonishingly high quality people. So from that port visit, we go in through the Suez Canal into the Indian Ocean, pick up some more. We were maxed out on ordnance, including warheads for the Tomahawks. And we started operating, and as you remember, we would go up into what was called the football, Straits of Hormuz. The Iranians and the Iraqis had been at war with each other for a number of years, and they had started attacking tankers with mines and machine guns. And our mission was to... Yeah, exactly. So our mission was to go up in a little piece of international water where you could rotate and radiate, right?
Yeah.
You could rotate and radiate your weapons, guns, and be a full-fledged warship. And as soon as we went up there, the net test, the push to test, what happens when you put a battleship, when you put Iowa into that war zone, it simply stopped. The Iranians simply shut down. Okay, and for several hours, nothing happened while we were up there. That was our purpose of being there. And as we were sailing the last day, that's when Bob Hope and the folks came out there to celebrate, that wonderful time. As we're sailing away, one of the young sailors who was a starboard lookout, I think, had joined us sometime during the cruise. As we were heading out to go around the corner and head back up to the Red Sea towards Suez, he said, Captain, we were so good, we didn't have to shoot. They knew who we were. All right? If there was any one thing that ever tells you what high-quality ship this was, it was the fact that it was really good donuts at 3 o'clock in the morning. We had these wonderful families, that engineering plant could do anything. Gunnery could do anything you want, that you had this repair department that could not only fix our ship, but fix everybody else inside. It was an amazing ship. And so when we would come back through here, headed back into the pier, this was America's best ship coming home. I have always been proud of every one of you. Glad to have you here today. And thanks for everybody who organized this. To celebrate not only the loss of those 47 shipmates, but to celebrate the extraordinary accomplishments that every one of you, including the family members, did in our ship. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. I'm going to open things up. We're going to open things up so people can come up and speak. Kathy.
Okay, I just want everybody to know, in case you don't know who this little furry guy is here on the podium, his name is Victory, and he's the USS Iowa ship's mascot. And I'm not doing a commercial or anything, but you have to go to the ship to buy one in LA. They sell them in the gift shop. First of all, what I want to say is many of you guys know, you knew my mom. She was here for years. She passed away last year on May 16th, and she loved every one of you. And this leads me into what I want to talk about very briefly here. We have a couple of guys that are former crew members of the Iowa that are in rehab right now. PTSD is a really big deal with a lot of the guys in our group. And one of the guys in particular that is a friend of mine from Texas started the process of going into the VA because he knew the 25th Memorial was coming up, and at Thanksgiving it really started bothering him. And it took him until 1 week ago to actually get into the VA. So he couldn't come here, although he planned to come here and be with us, because now he's getting help. And as Nancy Lewis, now Mac, touched on, a couple years ago at the 20th, those of us were there will remember how she said that you guys really need to support each other. It's time to think about yourselves. The 25th Memorial is still, really, I still need you to understand the importance of getting help if you need it, because there are still a lot of you out there that are having problems, and I just want you to know there's still people going in, so help is available, and please get it if you need it.
I lost my brother, Peter Edward Bob, but I gained many brothers with you folks over the years. That is the part of the good that came out of all this bad for me. I'm going to read a poem that was written in honor of my brother. For us, it captured the true essence of him and continues to carry us on. There was a young man who had a dream. of bowling ships and the sea. He was bright and warm and full of life and as eager as could be. A special boy who was loved by all, a friend to all in need, a son to be so proud of, a brother who could lead. And then one day, without a word, without a sign or clue, his life was taken from us. His dream was over too. He touched us all. We won't forget. We'll never be the same. His smile will live forever, and Peter is his name.
Hello, I'm Michael Prokopis, and I was a junior officer on board the USS Iowa, and it's great to see so many familiar faces. We've touched upon the ramifications of 25 years ago, and I'm proud to say that I was feeling a lot of disenfranchisement myself over the last few years, but you guys have really helped a lot, and I want to say thank you. I was proud of those 47 men, and I'm just as proud of the 1,700 who served with me as well. And all of us share a common bond, and we'll share that for the rest of our lives. But it's good to get together and just smile and laugh and talk about the times that we had on cruise. And I want to just share two quick stories with you from two great men who were mentors to me all these years later. And I've only told it to one of them, but I did mention a story today to Captain Seaquist. I was a young officer on board the Isle. I'd been on for 3 days. I was my first junior officer of the deck watch. And we were driving, and Captain Seaquist came up to me and he said, "Mr. Prokopis, this is not your mother's station wagon. This is a Ferrari. Would you please drive her like one?" And all I can think of is a battleship that's going to take 800 yards to turn around. I went away to Surface Warfare Officer School. When I came back, we'd had a change of command, and Captain Musali was now the captain of the ship. And he took me up to the O-11 level, where we had some fire control equipment. And he said to me, "This piece of equipment has never worked. You have 30 days. Figure it out." And what those two men have done is they set a level of excellence that we all could stand and live up to. And I got to tell you, it carries me to this day and everything that I want to do. So I want to say thank you to them for setting a standard that all of us can be proud of. And I want to say thank you to all of you to coming out on a cold, blustery day, but remembering a lot of fond memories and a lot of great people that we served with. Thank you.
My name is Barbara Shashir. My husband, Alvin Shashir, was on the Iowa. In 2009, I came to the Iowa after meeting Dan to participate in the 20th anniversary. While I was here, my husband had a massive heart attack. But I'm here today, 25 years later, in his name, and also to thank the men of the USS Iowa that have become my friends and my family. Thank you, Kathy, for welcoming me, and I just appreciate it. I just wanted to say thank you.
Good morning, I'm Mark Gustafson. I want to thank all the first timers who came out here. Libby, you're one of them. Welcome aboard, and anybody else. It's good to have you guys here. I think this is the first time I've ever seen more decades than Snipes. But you know, that's all right. But I just want to say that, you know, we're here every year, guys. So come down and, you know, do the memorial service with us. We got a huge hospitality room at the hotel, 1211 Atlantic Ave at the Surfside Inn and Suites. So come on down there tonight and share some sea stories. Thank you.
Love you, Mark.
If anybody here from 2nd Division, if 2nd Division, come stand behind me, please. 2nd Division, please come stand behind me real quick.
Mark, what are you turning over to the decade for?
The decade. My name is Seaman Hawkins. When the explosion happened on the turret, I was a young buck, like 19 years old. I was part of a recovery team, so I went in and seen some things I shouldn't have seen. It's still with me to this day. It took a lot for me to come here today, y'all. It's been a while. So I joined the Iowa Association this year for the first year. suffer from PTSD. Very bad, very bad. And they advised me to come here today. And I think it's the best decision I could have made in my life. Seeing these guys behind me yesterday, it helped me more than any therapy could have ever. I just want to thank everybody for coming out. I want to thank you guys for helping me get through this tough time of my life. Thank you.
Good morning, I am Pagan. I'm the jack of the dust and a cook and all that stuff. I cooked their omelets that morning. They love my omelets. They love my food. And it never was the same after that. Even to a simple act like eating an omelet reminded me of them for 25 years. Whatever I do, you know, I always remember. Many friends, because guys love the cooks, not all the cooks, but most of them. But thank you for being here.
Good morning. I too, I'm glad to be here. I mean, to look around and see some of the old shipmates, it just brings back a bunch of memories. Some good, some bad. You know, like some of them say, we got a chance. Not only did the ship run good, we also made it look good now. And somebody had to make it look good, and that was us. So, and we call holy hell. Sometimes late at night, getting up, Chief Hell, I used to run from work, I ain't gonna tell you no lie. We talked about it yesterday, I could hide in the VTs, I could hide I used to mess crank it in the offices, I could hide up there.
Go off the holy stone!
I could hide. Game, man, what's up? But I too, suffering from PTSD, was also advised to come in and come and visit with a couple of my shipmates, and I'm glad I did it. I'm telling you, we go through a whole lot, and we deny some things that are actually wrong with us. I too, you know, thinking there's nothing wrong with me. There's nothing wrong with me. Yes it is. Yes it is. Don't ever think that there's nothing wrong with you. I mean, I wanted 11 survivors, 47, you know, I could think of a name, and you know, and I'm pretty sure all you all know Foley. And that guy could seem like he could seem like an angel, bird. Man, to actually sit down and be talking to people and to understand, you can hear this man actually singing, Ribbon in the Skies. Hey, and go get some help. Don't sit around and wait on it. It's not gonna come to you. No one is gonna tell you, man, something's wrong with you. You gotta go get it. Go get some help. And I really do appreciate somebody like a Mendez. That guy was like a father figure to me. I was only like 19, 20 years old when I first got to the ship. Somebody had to take me under their wings. I appreciate Mendez. Yeah, after they found me. I appreciate that. God bless you all.
I'm Jim Bushkin, 1st Division, BM-3. I just want to thank my 1st Division brothers for being there all these years. I'll tell you what, without these guys, I'd be one of the 22 that we lose every day to PTSD. It's not a joke, man. 22 every day. Eat a bullet. That's horseshit. These guys need help. VA needs to get these guys help. We need the help. Don't fool yourselves, guys. It's going to come up and bite you on the ass when you least expect it. Get the help, man. Get the help. Admit it. Get the help. I'm proud of these guys, man. These are my brothers, and you guys are all my brothers and sisters. Just. Thank you. That's it. That's all I wanted to say.
Just give me one second. This is why we're here. 15 years ago at the 10th anniversary, we had a lot of things going on that weekend. It was the first time we put the families and the crew together since the explosion. magic happened that weekend because the healing began. I've been organizing this for 15 years now with a great team of people to help. And each year, new people come. Each year, their healing begins. It is awesome to watch you guys. Thank you. Come on.
Before he gets started, I just got two words to say. Christmas lights.
Hey, everybody knows I'm Mud Drum. A mud drum is part of a boiler. My last name is Meldrum, Mud Drum. You can see how I got the nickname. But Mark said we were outnumbered by the decades. I want every engineer that served on board to get up here. All B Division, E Division, M Division, A Gang, everybody, come on up.
Turn your back. Bang the hammer. Get up.
Rocking the freeway.
We're still waiting for him to get there.
Where's Mark?
Marking! These smart Trishans, please. Very chasing.
How much money, Larry, did you get out of this group?
If the snipes don't move, if the snipes don't groove, the ship don't move.
How you doing, guys? My name is Mark Garifano from Staten Island, New York. Jeffrey Scott Schlitt. This was my best friend. You guys really didn't know him. He only was on board the IOWA a couple of months. We served together on the Coral Sea. The med cruised, everything. We tore up the med. Jeff had wrote me a letter in November of 88 saying he had a surprise for me. His dream from since I knew him was to be aboard the IOWA. He's a gunner's mate. In 1989 I was working. I heard about the explosion and, you know, my heart just went out to everybody. It took about 3 weeks till I found out that he was actually on the ship. And wrote the chaplain at the time. He had sent me a letter stating that Jeff was indeed on board. I contacted Jeff's mom, Darlene. Again, she confirmed it, and I was heartbroken. I just wanted to say that for the few months that you guys knew him and the years that I knew him, he was a great guy. And if it wasn't for Michelle and Mock, 5 years ago, I reached out to them to say that I wanted to come. I felt out of place, and you guys did it for me. You guys made me feel at home 5 years ago. I'm back again today. I'll be back again. Mark Harding, he's out in LA, and he told me actually say hi to everybody. He's another one that helped me. 5 years ago, that's that. I just wanted to say that Jeff's an awesome guy. I miss him. I love him. And my heart goes out to all you guys, you know.
Just a couple of quick thank yous before we leave. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, for coming. Thank you, Larry. Thank you. Where's Dan? He was right there. Okay, he's back in the corner. Thank you. I'd invite everybody from Ops to come up, but there's probably only two or three of us, so that's okay. U.S. Somebody's got to do it. Come on. U.S. Fleet Forces Band, let's give them a hand. They did a great job. Thanks, guys. Ladies and gentlemen, come out in this horrible weather for us. Wow. Appreciate that. Sean Van, how do we say Sean's last name? Van Assen. He's from Harmony Township, New Jersey, played the bagpipe for us. Thanks, Sean. The Virginia Patriot Guard. Again, the Office of the Mayor of Norfolk, Virginia. Thank you very much, Mayor. Your presence here means a lot. Thank you. Naval Surface Force, U.S. Atlantic Fleet, and Naval Facilities Engineering Command, Mid-Atlantic. They're responsible for this. Thanks, guys. Last but not least, she didn't want me to mention her name, but Terry Davis is the base public affairs officer. Yay! Nothing could ever be done without you and your amazing team. Thank you very much. We owe all of this to you. Thank you. And Lonnie's going to come up and give us a closing prayer.
I tell my students that memorials aren't for those really that have passed. You know, we're surrounded, the Bible says we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, and there are 47 of them kind of watching over us now. But memorials are for us to kind of pull us out of our everyday normal routine to kind of check ourselves and how we're doing. And you know, Lincoln, when he was talking at the Gettysburg Address, he says it's for us, the living rather, to be here dedicated for that cause which they so nobly advanced. And it's on our patches, you know, our liberties we maintain, our liberties we prize, our rights we will maintain. Yeah, it's on your shirts, on the patches. And I want to close with prayer just so we know that everybody's telling the stories of we have great crew. We have great crew. We got great friends. And that's what this is about. We remember those that have passed and we honor them to give honor to whom honor is due. But it's about relating and connecting. And when this is over, we're all going our separate ways. And I just want to pray that we have God's peace. Heavenly Father, thank you that you've put together such an amazing crew. The reason it's called a compliment. And God, I ask for all these friends, all these brothers and sisters, as they go their separate ways, that you'd be with them. And they have fair winds and following seas. And for the remainder of this day, and all the stories been told, I pray that just bring honor to our brothers that have gone on. And get us home safely and bring everybody back again for 26 and 27. And we give you praise, we give you glory for all the goodness you have put on us. That's this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.